For qubits, there's another way to write them down in terms of the Bloch sphere. If you're not familiar with the Bloch sphere, go back to week 0 and watch the video explaining the Bloch sphere. When we talk about qubits, not as vectors, but as density matrices, there is a very nice geometrical way to understand these density matrices in terms of the Bloch sphere. Let me remind you, you have the Bloch sphere, and here is my qubit. So rho is the density matrix of my qubit. Because rho is a matrix, we can of course also write it in terms of basis elements, a basis for matrices, like we can for vectors. For a qubit, our rho is a 2x2 matrix. And one basis for the 2x2 matrices is given by the identity matrix x, z, and y, where these are the Pauli matrices. Pauli matrices are orthogonal under what is called the Hilbert-Schmidt inner product. This means, for example, that the trace of z times x is 0, and also the trace of the identity with x is 0. In the lecture notes, you can find more information about the fact that also the other matrices are orthogonal under the Hilbert-Schmidt inner product. All of these matrices are orthogonal, so we can express rho in the following way. Rho equals half times the identity matrix, some variable vx times x, some variable vz times z, and some variable vy times y. Because the Pauli matrices are orthogonal, it also means that the identity times x has trace 0. And because we want that the trace of rho is 1, the coefficient in front of the identity matrix is fixed. This means that we can characterize a 1-qubit density matrix fully in terms of this vector vx, vz, vy. I'm not going to prove this here, but you can find in the lecture notes that rho being a density matrix is equivalent to this vector, which we will call the Bloch vector, having length at most 1. Let's have a look to what this actually means. In the Bloch sphere, we often write the axes x, z, and y. And this now just corresponds to these three coordinates, x, z, and y. This means that if I decompose rho in this form, I can immediately see where I should draw it in the Bloch sphere. For pure states, it turns out that all pure states are living on the surface of the Bloch sphere, meaning that the Bloch vector has length 1. You could also see this here, because here we had only parameterized the angles, but we had only parameterized points on the surface of the sphere. A mixed state, such as for example the maximally mixed state, where all of, in fact, the numbers are 0. So for the maximally mixed state, lives in the inside of the Bloch sphere. In particular, the maximally mixed state is in fact at the origin of the Bloch sphere. The block sphere forms a very nice representation for qubits, and it's also nice when we think about qubits as density matrices. In the lecture notes, you can find a lot of examples about the block sphere. The block sphere will form a very nice visual tool with which we can prove the security of the quantum one-time path.